Hello and welcome to Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle. In this lecture, we're going to discuss the restoration of Mariology under the pontificate of Pope St. John Paul II. But before we get into that subject, I want to complete the subject of the last lecture, which was concerning a proposed fifth Marian dogma. We discussed the elements that led to the last two Marian dogmas, the theological foundations, ecclesiastical support, and petitions from the faithful. We talked about reasons of appropriateness in terms of defining the fifth doctrine, presently a fifth doctrine of Our Lady, as the spiritual mother of all peoples under its three essential aspects. Our Lady is human co-redemptrix with Jesus, mediatrix of all graces with Jesus, and advocate with Jesus. There's one remaining question that we should discuss, and the question would be, why is it necessary? Why would it be advantageous? Why is it opportune to define this fifth doctrine, which is already binding on the hearts of the faithful as an authentic doctrine, as taught by the papal magisterium? Why define it? What would be, once again, the particular and the theological rationale for a definition, along with the arguments of appropriateness that we discussed in the last lecture? Well, the fundamental answer from a theological perspective is that it always pleases God when the whole truth of revelation is proclaimed. Why? Because our freedom is exercised, and that allows God's full power to be operative. That also is true regarding Mary's participation in the works of God. Let me give you an example. Let's go to Matthew 16, verses 15 through 20, the institution of the papacy. Now you'll recall that Jesus says to the apostles, "Who do they say that I am?" Now, why would Jesus say that? Was Jesus having an identity crisis? Of course not. He wanted to hear the truth freely proclaimed by Simon, he who is to become Peter. And so Simon steps up and says, "You are the Son of God. You are the Christ, the Son of God." And then Jesus confirms that this does not come from the human mind of Simon, but by the Holy Spirit, and then says, "You are Peter," and effectively institutes the papacy. So the papacy is only instituted after a human being freely exercised their freedom to acknowledge the truth. It always pleases Jesus when truth is freely proclaimed by his disciples. And so analogously, that's true about this fifth Marian dogma, that Jesus wants to hear it proclaimed and proclaimed by his representative on earth, the vicar of Christ. And in doing this, the freedom of the Pope, and of course the faithful who encourage the Pope to do this, allows then, in that order of freedom, the full activation of Our Lady's intercessory powers, the full empowerment, to use a contemporary term. It allows Mary to have full exercise of her roles as co-redemptrix, mediatrix, advocate for the church and the world today. And I think most of us can say without too much hesitation, we can use that. We need, the church and the world today need the full exercise of Mary's titles in action, the functions of her motherhood. Now, is that to suggest that Mary is not interceding as the spiritual mother of all peoples now? Of course not. Of course she's interceding now, but not as fully as she could with this proclamation by the Vicar of Christ. The Vicar of Christ holds the keys to the kingdom. And when he freely chooses to use those keys, to unlock the full truth about Mary, to use the St. John Paul II expression, then and only then can Mary fully activate, fully exercise her roles as the co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate for the church and the world today. Remembering again, her titles are her functions. And when humanity, represented by the Vicar of Christ, acknowledges in a solemn way that we believe that she is the spiritual mother of all peoples, then and only then can she fully activate those roles for the church and the world in a historic release of grace. We can say confidently that with every Marian dogma, there's been a historic release of grace. In a special way, it was the conviction of Cardinal Mercier who began this movement that when we acknowledge Our Lady's role as mother to us in the order of grace, as the Second Vatican Council would call her, that's going to allow that role of being spiritual mother to bring forth a historic grace for the church and the world. Something that would be in conformity with the Fatima promise that in the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph and a period of peace will be granted to the world. It's interesting that Cardinal Mercier, who starts the movement for the Fifth Marian Dogma back in 1915, and then the private revelational confirmation, and as we stressed in the last lecture, private revelation cannot be the foundation, but surely when you have two locally churched apparitions, church-approved apparitions, I should say, in Amsterdam in 2002, in Akita in 1984, approved by the local bishops as being of a supernatural origin, it certainly is in conformity with that idea that Our Lady, once she's acknowledged, once this dogma is proclaimed, will then be able to fully exercise these gifts, these graces, for the great gift of world peace. So it's a nice congruity, complementarity of the development of this doctrine and the call for a fifth Marian dogma from within the church and then to at least two, in this case, local church-approved apparitions where Our Lady at Amsterdam explicitly and a dozen times asks for this fifth Marian dogma and presents it as a condition for world peace with the apparitions of Akita, Japan as confirming it in the sense that it's derived, the mystical phenomena is derived from an image of the Lady of All Nations, the apparitions in Amsterdam. So I just wanted to complete that lecture on why theologically it certainly makes sense that a solemn proclamation of Mary's roles as our spiritual mother would indeed lead to a monumental, a historic release of grace, and in particular, the grace of peace, the peace of Jesus in our hearts, but also a global peace, as was also prophesied at Fatima. Well, let's now segue into St. John Paul II, his Mariological restoration. And here I'm going to summarize, because indeed this again could be a subject of multiple lectures, and this is, you know, in essence an introductory course to Mariology. And so, but I want you to be aware not only of the great Mariological contribution of St. John Paul II, but also his corrective, what could properly be called a corrective of a direction of Mariology which happened after the Second Vatican Council, not because of the Council, but after the Council, that deserved a return to, again, his common expression, testifying to the, quote, whole truth about Mary. Let's summarize with the following distinctions. It is the distinction between what is called Mariology, Christotypical Mariology, and Ecclesiotypical All right, let's define our terms and talk about them then historically. What is Christotypical Mariology? Christotypical Mariology essentially asks the question, who is Mary in relation to Jesus? And it's very important, my friends, to establish and to understand that Christotypical Mariology, the answer to that question, who is Mary in relation to Jesus, has been the foundation for classic and classical Mariology. Not only the greatest contributors to Mariology, but also the papal teachings regarding Our Lady. Who is Mary in relation to Jesus? And of course, that answer starts with the fact that she's the mother of God. And we'll find those other four dogmas all focus on the uniqueness of Mary's relation with Jesus. So this, I would say again, please underscore, Christotypical Mariology is the foundation for all true and classic Mariology. Ecclesiotypical, and that's a little C there, Ecclesiotypical Mariology asks the question, who is Mary in relation to the church? Now, this is also a very fruitful question, and it was a question asked in a very significant way at the Second Vatican Council. How is Mary a model for us? How are we called to imitate her virtues? How is she a model for the church? And we talked about types and models as well in the last lecture. So this is asking the question, how can the church learn from Mary? In what ways does Mary embody the church? And ultimately as well, the church, how is the church called to direct itself to becoming more and more like Mary, who is the greatest member of the church? So both of these are very positive sources of about the truth of Our Lady. Here is the million-dollar distinction, my friends. Christotypical Mariology must always remain the foundation for all authentic Mariology. Now, what does that mean in common parlance? It means that everything that Our Lady is comes from her relation to Jesus. And all the positive dimensions of ecclesiotypical Mariology, which derive how we should imitate Our Lady, what Mary means to the church, has to first be founded on the things of Mary's uniqueness with Jesus. And this would lead to a certain challenge that would happen, that would manifest itself in the 1950s. What challenge? The difficulty enters in, and again, I have to generalize because of the limitations of our time in this course and it being an introductory course to Mariology. The difficulty came in when, with some writers in the 1950s, particularly from Germany and Austria, that would tend to limit the truth about Mary to only questions of ecclesiotypical significance. In other words, the idea that since Mary is a member of the church, and even saying that Mary is the first member of the church, there grew out of this emphasis on ecclesiotypical Mariology a tendency to want to say nothing about Mary that could not be said about every other member of the church. Now, let's be very clear about the distinction. Mary is the preeminent model of the church, but there's elements that you and I, as members of the church, if indeed you're a member of the church, we could certainly have brother and sister Christians and even non-Christians participating in this class, but for those who are Catholics, clearly there's aspects about the truth about Mary that is not true about us. For example, even a strong affirmation day, we should not think that we were immaculately conceived. We were not, she was. We should not, within the bounds of rationality, think that we were individually the mother of God. She was, uniquely. And so The danger is not with ecclesiotypical Mariology in itself. The danger enters where typical Mariology seeks to usurp the primary position of Christotypical or Christocentric Mariology. And I want to say that again. There's nothing intrinsically wrong with ecclesiotypical Mariology, seeing Mary as a model, seeing Mary as the predominant and the preeminent member of the church. She certainly is that. But she's also beyond the things that all other members of the people of God share. And so what happened, and again, I have to excuse the generalizations here, but we simply don't have the time and the appropriateness in this course to talk about the specific authors that were kind of leading this charge and certain interpretations. But a new hesitancy entered the discussion of Mariology where there was a hesitation to say anything about Our Lady that we couldn't say about us. This, my friends, was a very dangerous minimalism. And minimalism means saying, as we talked about earlier, too little about Mary. And so that means practically you could call Mary our sister, our example of discipleship, but you wouldn't call Mary mother. You wouldn't call Mary queen, but she is mother and queen, and we are not. And so this tendency to ascribe to Our Lady only what we can ascribe to us as members of the church led to what authors like Cardinal Ratzinger would call a decade without Mary. And the general commentary on what that means was that for the 10 years after the Second Vatican Council, which most historians and theologians would say was more like 20 years, there was a new hesitancy to speak the full truth about Our Lady. And my friends, when you do that, when there's a hesitancy to speak the full truth about Our Lady, to call her sister rather than mother, to talk about her as intercessor, but not as mediatrix, as all the popes, as you know well, referred to her as, to call her a member, the first in the kingdom of God, but to refuse to call her queen, which she is, this will impact devotion. This will impact the people of God. This will impact a love of Our Lady. And in fact, as again, Cardinal Ratzinger and many other commentators said, this led to a decade without Mary where people were hesitant, I use the word again, hesitant to give her the full love she deserves in light and based on the full truth about her. So I say just as a summary statement, ecclesiotypical Mariology is very positive in reflecting on how Our Lady tells us, teaches us, exemplifies for us how we are to be church, how we are to be the people of God. But we must be true to our Catholic tradition and to be true to the teachings of the papal magisterium. We must ascribe to things of Our Lady that we cannot ascribe to anybody else in the church. That's why Mary is at one time, mysteriously, the number one member of the church, the greatest disciple of the church, but she also is that which anticipates the church. So let's go back to the Annunciation as just one manifestation of this. Mary's yes to the Archangel Gabriel allows both Jesus Christ, the head of the church, and secondly, all of us as members of the church to enter the beauty of what we call the church today. Again, the words of St. Pius X in 1904 in Mystici Corporis, that we all mysteriously come forward from the womb of Mary. So Mary's yes allows the church to become, which of course presupposes that Mary exists. So that's why, in that sense, Mary anticipates the church. She herself is mysteriously both mother of the church and the first disciple of the church. And that's why we have to be willing to say things about Our Lady that we simply cannot truly say about us. So this was the great challenge. And unfortunately, and again, this is not an assessment of culpability. It's just historical fact and theological fact. Unfortunately, several Marian academies took on this new minimalism and, in fact, kind of championed it for this period of ambiguity for what really constituted some 20 years after the council. Now, of course, unfortunately, some continue to entertain this idea of saying we can't really say anything about Our Lady that we can't say about the rest of us in the church. But it would simply be erroneous to hold that, because if you logically bring that to fruition, it means you cannot call Mary Mother of God exclusively, Immaculate Conception exclusively, Co-Redemptrix, Mediatrix, Advocate, Queen exclusively, but she is. And that's what Jesus wants. Jesus wants us to acknowledge the unique truth and to have a unique love for his mother and our mother that goes beyond other members of the people of God. And that should not be too challenging for us, in fact, because obviously we do not have the prerogatives, the God-given prerogatives of Our Lady. And so as this was taking place, again, coming out of predominantly Germany and Austria, a little bit in France as well, some in the Netherlands, the rationale for this was the protection of Christian unity effort. So once again, we see that it was justified under the auspices of ecumenism. So I will again speak about ecumenism when we get to, at least as a brief example, of St. John Paul II's great Marian encyclical, Redemptoris Mater. But to reiterate what the Pope says in his encyclical on ecumenism, Ut Unum Sint, I'll spell that for you. So, Sint, okay. That they may all be one, from John 17. That authentic Christian unity and efforts, which is an imperative for the church, can never lead to a compromise of either the truth about Our Lady or the doctrinal development about Our Lady. St. John Paul II calls that a false ecumenism, because it's not being true to the doctrinal teachings and even the development the Holy Spirit can be calling for at any given age about the truth about Our Lady. So now, why do we bring this up in the lecture on St. John Paul II? Because St. John Paul II almost single-handedly offers the restoration of authentic Mariology. And I'll say for a third time, there are certainly generalizations as I'm presenting this because time does not permit the specifics. But these generalizations are based on a foundation of theological and historical truth. In his 1987 encyclical on Our Lady, and the only encyclical on Our Lady since that time, St. John Paul II offers a corrective to the tendency which continued to linger in the church, and that's why the decade without Mary that Cardinal Ratzinger and others refer to really was almost a 20-year span. St. John Paul II, in his encyclical, Redemptoris Mater, or Mother of the Redeemer, an encyclical I very strongly recommend you to read yourself, offers an organic correction to the tendency and to the ill fruits, the minimalist fruits, of having ecclesiotypical Mariology usurp the primacy of Christotypical Mariology. In other words, emphasizing Mary in relation to the church more than Mary's uniqueness with Jesus Christ. Now, how does St. John Paul II do this? The very structure of the document, and again, we don't have time to get into many of the commentaries that St. John Paul II produced, even during his Wednesday audiences, where he talked about the tendency at the council, while never bringing any question about the protection of the Holy Spirit, about the integrity of the council, but the tendency of people to interpret the council as if it were seeking to de-emphasize Mary, to minimalize the truth about Our Lady. But the clearest example of John Paul's correction comes in this encyclical. And we see it in the very structure of the encyclical itself. Chapter 1 of Mother of the Redeemer, I'll give you the Latin of Redemptoris Mater as well. Okay. Here's the structure of the document. Chapter 1. Mary in the Mystery of Christ. Classic Christotypical Mariology. And he does a beautiful summation of an introduction. He will continue. In fact, Christotypical Mariology throughout the document, and then we'll have an emphasis on the ecclesiotypical Mariology in chapter 2, as I'll mention it in a moment. But very clearly, he starts the examination of Mary in the mystery of Christ. Thanks be to God. That's classic Mariology and must always become and continue to be the foundation, properly said, the foundation of Mariology. Chapter 2, Mary in the Mystery of the Pilgrim Church. Beautiful. Then he can emphasize Mary in relation to the church after the uniqueness of Mary in relation to Jesus has been given as the foundation. That's what eliminates minimalism. That's what eliminates both an absence of the full truth, which sadly led to an absence of the full love of Our Lady. The third and final chapter, maternal mediation. A beautiful, again, return to Christotypical Mariology. And that was simply the genius of St. John Paul II and the sanctity of St. John Paul II. It is not either Christotypical Mariology or Ecclesiotypical. It's both and with its proper hierarchy of Christotypical and then the fruits of Ecclesiotypical. So that's how St. John Paul II, in his teaching, corrects, restores the proper balance of Mariology and also complements and highlights the true benefits of ecclesiotypical Mariology when it remains in its humble, subordinate relationship to the truth about Our Lady in relation to Jesus. Okay, so having said that, I just want to give a few examples, a very brief example from each of these three chapters. So let's go to chapter 1. And again, these examples will not do any justice to the brilliance and the insight and the sublimity of Redemptoris Mater. I strongly encourage you to read it on your own to appreciate it. These are just a few token pearls of this treasure trove document, Mother of the Redeemer. In chapter 1, for example, he will give a beautiful scriptural commentary on Luke 11:28. Well, Luke 11:28 is the passage of scripture where the woman from the crowd yells out, "Blessed is the womb that bore you and the breasts that gave you suck." And Jesus responds, "Even more so blessed." And I mention that translation because some of the English translations mistranslate and say rather. It's not rather. The Greek is menoun or menoun, which means yes, but even more though. Blessed is the kingdom of God. Even more so. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. So St. John Paul II says, the purpose of Jesus' response is to emphasize the spiritual priority of the kingdom of God, those who hear the word of God and keep it. And he uses his human relation with his mother to say even above blood relation is the spiritual priority of being faithful to the kingdom of God. But he continues to say this does not denigrate, this does not reduce the importance of indeed his human mother. And so, as St. John Paul II will conclude, he will say, in fact, the greeting of the woman from the crowd coincides with the admonition, the teaching of Jesus that even more so, blessed it is to hear the word of God and to keep it, they coincide precisely in Mary. Mary is both the woman, the womb who gave Jesus life, the breast that suckled him, and she's the first to hear the word of God and to keep it. In fact, she heard the word of God so profoundly, she gave flesh to the word of God. So far from it being a sign of a derogatory comment to Our Lady, it's in fact the fulfillment of both what the woman in the crowd says and what Jesus says in Our Lady. And this is, again, part of the brilliance of St. John Paul II. Let's go to the second chapter. And again, I would encourage you to read the number 21 in the first chapter. St. John Paul II has a beautiful commentary on Cana. And he will say, this is number 21, he will say that Mary acts as a mediatrix, not as an outsider, but in her position as mother, and she has the right to do so. And that, again, will be a foundation and an undergirding of St. John Paul II's contribution that Mary is a maternal mediatrix. She mediates as a mother. And he will say that the miracle of Cana outlines Mary's new universal motherhood, which will ultimately be seen in its entirety at Calvary with those words, "Behold your mother." Let's go to the second chapter. An example of the second chapter we see in number 29. And that is St. John Paul II's discussion of Mary and ecumenism. In short, the Holy Father says, the path of the church is marked by the mission of ecumenism. I don't think anyone would say there was anyone more dedicated to Christian unity during his pontificate than St. John Paul II. And yet he will say the following, that unity of faith must be based on unity of doctrine. Once again, unity of faith must be based on unity of doctrine. And there are two inseparable truths. The truth about the incarnation, the Word becoming flesh, and the truth about the divine motherhood of Mary. He therefore says, Christian unity efforts, ecumenical efforts, should have greater study, not less, not avoiding the Mary issue, but greater study on Mary as the model of faith. He will then conclude, and this again in number 29, it's well worth your time to read, he will conclude that Mary is not the obstacle, but she's the mother of the ecumenical movement. In his expression, this is used in number 34, that she is, quote, our common mother. So St. John Paul II will confirm what he will later write in 1994, once again in Ut Unum Sint, that you cannot justify a compromise of truth regarding Our Lady for any proposed ecumenical reason, because that would be a false ecumenism. True ecumenism means that the Holy Spirit, through the Immaculate Heart of Mary, who is Mother, will unite Christians in ways beyond our abilities, but we are obliged. We must speak the full truth about Our Lady as it's taught by the Church. Finally, one example from chapter 3, and again, these are just sample pearls of this great document. In number 45, St. John Paul II talks about a, quote, filial entrusting to the Mother of Christ. And he's commenting on John 19, 25 through 27. And he will essentially say that the gift of Mary's motherhood is a personal gift given from Jesus at Calvary to every single individual. Again, my friends, notice he's saying not only is Mary's gift in the words, "Behold your mother," not only is that a universal gift, it's a personal gift from Jesus to you, from Jesus to me. And so we want to receive that personal gift as it is, and that's receiving Mary as our mother. Once again, the line of Pope Francis is relevant. The Christian without Mary is an orphan. That means it's so far less than what God desires, what Jesus granted us in giving us the gift of Mary. So John Paul will conclude that we're all called to imitate John and to take Mary into our home, or properly with the Greek, as we've said before, into our own. St. John Paul II will say, own means inner life, our spiritual life. And so if we imitate John, the beloved disciple, we will therefore be performing a filial entrusting to the mother of Christ. Filial means a son or daughter-like entrusting. Entrusting, as it is in the Polish, is almost synonymous with consecration to the mother of Christ. So in that passage in number 45, St. John Paul will essentially provide a biblical commentary for Marian consecration, because all Christians should seek to imitate the beloved disciple, John, and bring Mary into our own. So many, many more pearls in this document, but just a taste of the brilliance. And again, a proper historical and theological gratitude for this historic Saint Pope, who not only gives us a catechism and not only gives us a new code of canon law, and not only is an instrumental part of communism falling, and the list goes on and on, but he also becomes the corrective and the restorer of authentic classical and contemporary Mariology, where he does not hesitate to proclaim, in his words, the whole truth about Mary. Well, thank you so much for being with us in this extended lecture in Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle saying, God bless you all, and let's all do our best at trying to live the words of Jesus to behold our mother. Thank you.